Everybody, great to see you all this morning. I'll ask you to stand as we start with a song. We're going to sing, Blessed Be Your Name. Let's stand and let's praise and worship our God together this morning.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Welcome, everybody. I just ask you to turn around and greet those around you. Shake somebody's hand or bump somebody's elbow. Hey, thank you very much. You can be seated. Again, welcome everybody. It's just great to see everybody. And I just want a few introductions. So this morning, as most of you know, we have a guest speaker. So Pastor Andrew Bellows and his wife Monica And their two girls, you guys stand, Susanna and Rosalie, are here this morning. Also, Pastor Andrew's mom and dad are here, Reverend Ken and Dr. Joyce Bellows. They are right behind them. So welcome to them, and anybody else who's visiting, it's just great to have you all here. So a few things going on. Obviously, today's a great Sunday with Pastor Andrew speaking to us. He's also going to share in a story, children's story, and also special music. And immediately following the service, there's a potluck. Now, who doesn't like a potluck? I mean, come on. So there's a potluck. Everybody is welcome. Even if you didn't bring anything, there's always lots of food. So immediately following the service, after the communion, we're just going to head over, go out the doors, and hang a right. And there's going to be plenty of food. So everybody's welcome. It'll give you a chance to talk to Pastor Andrew and his family. And, yeah, just a great time. We're just excited about that. Also, tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we're going to have a congregational meeting. We're going to meet in the fireside room again. And it's just regarding, obviously, Pastor Andrew and that whole thing we got to deal with. So we're doing that tomorrow night. Everybody is welcome, but you do need to be a member of this church to vote. But all your input is certainly requested and desired, and you're all welcome to be there. So tomorrow night at 7 in the fireside room. Last night we had a little open house, and the fireside room was pretty full. We had just about 60 people in there, and it was just a great time to get to know them a little bit better. So thank you all for coming to that, and we're looking forward to tomorrow night. Tonight, quickly at 7, there's going to be a board meeting at the church here as well. And so that's tonight for the board and the deacons and the search committee. Also, just information, I am going to be gone for the next 3 Sundays. We're going to Germany. We're leaving on Saturday, right? Saturday, and we're back. I'm so confused. We're leaving on Saturday. We've had a little bit building up to this, so it's all good. We're leaving on Saturday, and we're back on the 27th. So if you have any questions or issues with the church, just contact Pastor Rick, and he can get a hold of me if it's an emergency. But just want you to know we'll still be praying for you guys while we're gone. And, yeah, we'll be over there for a couple weeks. So just wanted you to know that. Also, Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, there's the Deep Dive Bible Study, and that's also in the fireside room as well. And that's what they're dealing with, James 1, 2-8. So take note of that. That's probably all I have for announcements, so let me just pray, and then we will carry on. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We just thank you for being a great God, for being a God that loves us and cares about us as individuals, cares about us as a church, cares about us as a community. God, we just thank you for who you are, and God, we just pray that as we worship you through song, through music, through scripture, through the spoken word, God, that you would be glorified this morning. So we pray to that end in your name. Amen. I'll ask you to stand, and we will sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Let's stand and sing this together.
You by his grace and crown him Lord.
sacred throng we at his feet may fall. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Pastor Andrew, it's children's story time. So any children or anybody that identifies as a child, pick me, come on down. Pastor Andrew is going to share a story. There we go. A couple more coming.
You can and come Rick's and just sit in the front row here.
Rick, no heckling, okay? No heckling.
Well, today we are talking about one of the 12 disciples. Come on, have a seat. And the 12 disciples were people who were studying with Jesus. Jesus was their teacher, and they were his students. And they loved Jesus. And something really hard happened to Jesus. Jesus offended some of the people in authority, and they killed him because they were so upset with him. Is that a good thing? No. And so the disciples were very sad, and they didn't know what they would do without Jesus as their teacher and leader. And then something really amazing happened. Some of the disciples, all except for one guy named Thomas, were gathered together talking about what they were going to do. And Jesus showed up and said that he wasn't dead anymore. Now, usually when people die, do they continue to walk around and talk with people? Usually when they die, they stay dead. That's what we normally expect. But Jesus came back to life and was able to visit with the people who loved him. And they were so excited that they told Thomas, guess what? Jesus is alive. And do you know what Thomas said back to him? I don't think so. When people die, they stay dead. I tell you what, if Jesus shows up and I get to put my hand and finger through the hole in his hand where they drove the nail, and when I get to put my hand at his side and feel where the spear punctured him as they were killing him, then I'll believe. Now, have you ever had somebody trick you? Somebody say that something was true, and then you found out later that they were joking or that they were trying to trick you? Has anybody ever had that happen to them? That's happened to me. And sometimes when we get tricked, it gets hard to trust people again. Sometimes people are just telling jokes and it's funny, but sometimes there are people out there who really try to trick you. And this was so hard for Thomas to believe that he thought even his best friends, the other disciples, were trying to trick him, or they were confused, or that something had gone wrong. He didn't believe them. And it wasn't until Jesus actually came and showed himself to Thomas, that Thomas believed. And it's important that we learn to trust and believe in Jesus, who has the power to give life when we don't have it for ourselves. So let's say a quick prayer, and then you can go back to your seats, okay? Father, we thank you that you sent Jesus to be here with us, to die for us, and then to show us that it's possible to live again if we trust in Jesus and you, our Father, and accept the Holy Spirit into our lives. These things we pray in your holy and powerful name. Amen. Okay, you can go back to your seat now.
Great, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Okay, if you're able, I'll ask you to stand again, and we'll sing two more songs. So if you're able, stand. The first one is entitled, Be Unto Your Name.
we are a moment, you are forever. Lord of the ages, God before time, we are a vapor, you are eternal. Love everlasting, reign.
Seated.
No, please stay
Don't
standing.
Stay standing.
We're going to read scripture and we'll stand for that. Let's hear the word of the Lord. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, My Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, Because you've seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who've not seen and yet believe. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, John. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Be seated, please. We have a special song with guitar accompaniment. Pastor Andrew, welcome.
Well, it's a great privilege to be here and to worship with you this morning. The music has been so excellent so far. Thank you to the worship team for that wonderful start to our service. And I'd like to play for you a song that I hope will contribute to the atmosphere of worship this morning. Speak to me in stillness with your quiet, gentle voice. And I will enter in and listen close. Your words will find me waiting, patient and alone. To know you are the one who loves me most. I will wait. Wind and fire show their force. I will wait here listening, discovering your still small voice. I am yet your servant, though broken and afraid, searching for your light to guide my way. Though the world be shaking, you're not in the quaking. And gentle whispers come, restore my faith. I will wait here listening. As wind and fire show their force, I will wait here. Discovering your still small voice, I will wait here listening. As wind and fire show their force, I will wait here listening. Discovering your still small voice. Speak to me in stillness with your quiet, gentle voice. And I will enter in and listen close.
Before we go into prayer this morning, just want to mention a couple of items that we will include in prayer, but maybe just give you a bit more information here. I spoke with Stan Humke. Oh, Stan, you're here today. And Stan had a birthday yesterday, and so he and I chatted for a while. And we just want to keep Stan in prayer because there are some health issues and some concerns that he would appreciate prayer for. So we will continue to do that. If you need more information and just chat with Stan yourself, you can do that over our potluck lunch or some other time. Also, Linda Krause has not been feeling well. She's been hit with that terrible flu bug, perhaps RSV, and so we want to keep her in our prayers as well. And then Gordon Canfield had eye surgery just on Friday, and he's in quite a bit of pain after that rather serious eye surgery. He's not here today. He's our head usher, so we want to keep him in our prayers too. Then, of course, I got also here a message from Helen Dublin, and she says, please pray for Daryl. And that's Helen Dublin's nephew in Prince Edward Island. He just had his leg amputated below the knee, and now he has an infection there. So we want to keep Daryl in our prayers. We don't know Daryl personally, but we know Abe and Helen Dublin, of course, as members of our congregation. So let's keep them in prayer. Now, I know that when we pray, we often talk about, and the psalmist does too, let's bow down before the Lord. It's not going to be that easy to bow down. We're going to stand up and lift our heads and hearts and hands in prayer. Join me. You'll be sitting for most of the rest of the service. This is our last chance to raise our hearts before the Lord in thanksgiving. We praise you, O God, for the Son of your love, for Jesus, who died and is now gone above. And he sits at your right hand. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Yours is all the honor and praise. Lord, we lift our hearts, our arms, our hands, our minds before you in humility. And though we are standing, we are bowed down real low because we confess that along with all the honor and glory and praise we give you, we confess as well that we have not lived up to your standards, because so often we're living up to your standards in our own energy and power. And what you want is for us to submit to the energy and the power that you have given us through your Holy Spirit and through the redeeming blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we come to you with adoration, as we come to you with our confession of our ineptitude and our shortcomings, we also are able to say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for making the difference in our life between life and death. Not just death on this earth, but death eternally. It's gone. As children of the Heavenly Father, we are able to come to you with life everlasting through our veins because of what we have experienced. And so now, Lord, as we come also today, we bring to you those whom we've mentioned, whether it be Stan Humke or Linda Krause, Gordon Canfield, and Daryl out in Prince Edward Island. At the same time, as we pray for these, we also pray that your word will flow forth mightily this morning to touch hearts and minds and lives. So we pray for Pastor Andrew as he comes and shares the message with us very soon now. For his wife Monica, for Susanna, and for Rosalie, thank you for bringing this family to us for this weekend, and we leave all in your wonderful sovereign hands, because you know what we need as a church, and you know what also will build your kingdom. And that's why we come to you with thanksgiving in all humility, expecting great things from you. And as we're about to receive this offering, we give you thanks that we're able to give for the working of your kingdom right here in Wetaskiwin and around the world also. And so now bless our time together in this fellowship of believers. And Lord, if there's anyone here this morning that yet has not found the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, may your word speak to them, soften our hearts, just open our minds so that we're able to say, oh, what a great God we have. Creator, sustainer of all, especially of our life. You have come to give us abundant life, and it's through this abundant life in which we're able to say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. Ushers, please come forward and receive the offering for this morning as we have a wonderful little children's video.
Stand right up and turn around. Wave your hands and touch the ground. Aren't you glad your strength comes from the Lord? Pull your ear, tap your toes, wink your eye and touch your nose. Aren't you glad your strength comes from the Lord?
You are my strength.
Yes, you are my strength.
You are my strength.
Lord, you are my strength. Take a bow and pinch your chin, flap your arms and give a grin. Aren't you glad your strength comes from the Lord? Clap your hands, stomp your feet, jump way up and take your seat. Aren't you glad your strength comes from the Lord?
You are my strength.
Yes, you are my strength.
You are my strength.
Lord, you are my strength. Stand right up and turn around, wave your hands and touch the ground. Aren't you glad your strength comes from the Lord? Pull your ear and tap your toes, wink your eye and touch your nose. Aren't you glad your strength comes from the Lord?
You are my strength.
Yes, you are my strength.
You are my strength.
Lord, you are my strength.
You
go. That had a real country flair to it. And Pastor Andrew's not a big country fan, so maybe that's why we threw that out there. Just before he comes, I wanted to just welcome Jack Knapp. It's great to see you here this morning. Thank you so much. You look great. So this morning, I've got a brief introduction here so you all know who is here with us this morning. So we're welcoming Reverend Andrew Bellows, his wife Monica, and their children, Susan and Rosalie. Andrew was born in Nova Scotia, grew up in Alberta, and Saskatchewan, and then moved to Ontario when starting university. Andrew earned a bachelor's degree in archaeology and history, worked in business for a time, and then returned to complete a Master of Divinity degree. Andrew has worked as solo, associate, and interim pastor, as well as youth director for various churches among the Canadian Baptists of Ontario and Quebec in the past 15 years. He has led worship for more than 30 years and served as deacon, camp director, Sunday school teacher, small group leader, and in many other roles, serving churches where he was a member and connected organizations. He has a heart for local churches and for the kingdom of God. Andrew values service beyond the local church. He served as the clerk for the Canada Central Association and as chair of the Oxford Brant Association Ministry Committee, guiding candidates through the ordination process. He chaired the Pembroke Area Clergy Association and supports interdenominational dialogue and engagement. Andrew also has experience in church construction, designing and installing audiovisual systems, professional lighting and video displays for churches and colleges. He has retrofitted existing churches and worked on new building construction. He has designed and built smart classrooms for Emmanuel Bible College and McMaster Divinity College to allow students around the world to study theology in Canadian classrooms while staying where they are. He has expertise in audio video production and online digital media distribution. Andrew enjoys developing new skills and strategies to advance the kingdom of God, yet knows that some things never change. He preaches the gospel faithfully while searching for new ways to make it known. We are pleased to welcome Pastor Andrew Bellows this morning.
Well, what a privilege it is to be here, but preaching for a call is always slightly awkward because you know that out there in everyone's mind there is a checklist. Does he speak well? Can I understand him? Does he have a sense of humor? Sadly, I do not, but I used to. I worked at Costco for a time, and they surgically removed my sense of humor because it would make me at least 14% more efficient. They did this by putting me on the return desk. That is all it took. But I'm in recovery. We're doing fine. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. For those new to the Christian faith, Jesus' death on the cross can be confusing. Easter doesn't get the attention that Christmas does in our society. Everyone understands Jesus' birth, Jesus coming to be with us. But the idea of celebrating the cross as a victory, a cruel and humiliating death, is hard to explain to those who haven't grown up with it. When it comes to Easter, most people are just in it for the chocolate eggs. Some years back, the movie The Passion of the Christ was released by Mel Gibson. And in talking with people after that movie came out, it seemed that people were typically divided into two camps. There were those who saw it as a brutal and unnecessary depiction of violence, and there were those who saw it as a deeply moving portrayal of suffering and sacrifice. Perhaps those with a pre-existing understanding of what happened on the cross were able to appreciate it in a way that those who were coming to the story for the first time were unable to. Now, those are, of course, broad generalizations. I know people who were people of faith who didn't appreciate the movie, and people who were not Christians who did appreciate the message that it portrayed. But it's funny how one's pre-existing understanding can affect how we see a story like that. Thomas was one of the 12 disciples, and there's not much more that we know about him for sure. Thomas is only specifically mentioned 11 times in the entire Bible. Once in Mark, once in Matthew, once in Luke, once in Acts, and then 7 times in the book of John. And the references in the Gospel of John are the only times in the whole Bible when Thomas isn't simply included in a list of the 12 disciples. It's only from the book of John that we get a sense of who Thomas really was, of his character. Those 7 references come from 3 moments when Thomas stands out from the other disciples, when he distinguishes himself from the rest of the group. In John 11, Thomas speaks to the other disciples, but it's really just an off-the-cuff comment. In John 14, Jesus is explaining heaven by using imagery of a house which has many rooms. Thomas gets impatient with all the airy-fairy half-explanations that he thinks that Jesus is using. And he challenges Jesus to just tell them where he is going so that they can follow him, not realizing that Jesus is speaking about his death and being resurrected and ascending into heaven. It's like Jesus is trying to explain the deep philosophical truths, and Thomas just wants to know the GPS coordinates so he can plug them into his phone and just go where they're going to go. That happens to me on occasion. Someone gives a long explanation about how to get to their house with turn-by-turn directions. Be sure to look out for the big grain elevator. Then you want to turn left. If you hit this point, you've gone too far. The reality is I just want their address, and I'm going to punch it into Google and go wherever Google tells me to go. I often don't have enough patience for the story that explains the journey, something I perhaps need to work on. The third time when Thomas stands out is the passage that we're looking at today, when the other disciples start saying among themselves that Jesus isn't dead any longer. Thomas, he doesn't buy it. Thomas refuses to believe without proof and then comes face to face with the proof that he demanded. Jesus, risen from the dead. Thomas gets a bad reputation from these three brief episodes. In one, he makes a somewhat enigmatic statement. In the second, he wants to know the coordinates for the afterlife. And in the third, he refuses to believe the other disciples without proof. From all of this, the poor guy gets saddled with the moniker Doubting Thomas. Well, I don't know about you, but I identify strongly with Thomas. I'm a practical type of person. And while I'm willing to believe, it doesn't always come easily to me. I'm a bit of a skeptic. I wasn't always a skeptic, though. I learned to be one. Once when I was in junior high school, I was at a church youth event, and we were all sitting around in someone's basement, casually chatting about a number of different topics. And someone said something that I took seriously when they didn't mean it to be a serious thing at all. And someone noticed this and said to me with exaggeration, "You know, Andrew, they took the word gullible out of the dictionary." And now this is the moment when I would like to be able to say that I immediately recognized this as a joke and that I understood and I chuckled and everything was fine. I did not. I took what he said seriously, and I began a tirade about how ridiculous it was that anyone would take the word gullible out of the dictionary, a word in common usage. And I was about 30 seconds into my rant when I noticed that everyone else was laughing, and I had become the butt of a joke. Fortunately, I was able to see the humor in the situation, and I was good friends with everyone in the room. So I was able to laugh at myself. But as I was thinking about doubt for this sermon, that moment stands out as a time in my life when I paid a price, a social price, for believing what someone else was telling me. Though I know it was done as a good-natured joke, I was made to feel stupid for believing someone. I was made fun of because I chose to trust. And that happens all the time in our society. There have been many other times in my life when a similar thing has happened to me, but without the strong relationship I enjoyed with that group. There is an overwhelming sense in our society that what is real, what is true, is clear and known and can be easily ascertained, especially now that we can just look everything up on Google. If someone doesn't know, then they clearly just haven't taken the time to find out. And so they are fair game to become the butt of the joke. We find comedy in ignorance. A person who doesn't understand the social etiquette of a particular situation is funny. How many times do we see a joke about which fork to use at the dinner table, or a parent trying to understand a new slang term that their child has come home from school with? How often do we laugh at someone thrust into an unfamiliar situation because they are from a different social level or a different culture? Now, I'm not even saying that these are inappropriate situations, because laughter can help draw us together. None of us can possibly know all of the things that we might want to know going through life. There is always something new to learn. And I think that humor is often used by a tool, as a tool by those around us to identify and recognize our own gaps in knowledge. It relieves the social anxiety and awkwardness by making our lack of knowledge a shared experience when we can laugh with one another about something that we didn't know about. It's a tool that can be used well or poorly, depending on the circumstances. As I think about belief and doubt and the acquisition of knowledge, I begin to realize how some of my early life experiences and interactions shaped me and influenced me, and how much I dislike being wrong. Plato said that the beginning of knowledge is the point at which we understand our own ignorance. We do not fix what we do not believe to be broken. An attitude of humility and openness allows us to understand our own ignorance. We do not take ourselves too seriously. We are able to hold ourselves lightly. Or we can adopt a brittle pride, which reacts poorly to the feedback that we might receive from others. For those unable to take themselves lightly, doubt can be a protection against ridicule. If we choose to believe in nothing, well, then we cannot be caught believing in the wrong thing. Believing is taking a stand and risking your reputation on a belief that might later be shown to be suspect. We as Christians are making a statement that we believe in the action of the Holy Spirit in our lives, in the person of Jesus Christ, who is our Savior, preparing us to come to God the Father, and the Scriptures, which are God's inspired word, which we trust to reveal God to us. When I hear or read of someone speaking against the things that I hold as sacred, it affects me on a number of levels. I react intellectually, bringing to bear my studies at Divinity College and the research that I've done, which assures me that what I read in Scripture is valid and true, trustworthy. I react spiritually, considering the motives this other person might have for his or her statement, and I feel concerned for that other person's spiritual life. And I also react emotionally, feeling those feelings of fear that I might have misunderstood what I have studied. I feel afraid that I've been led astray and that this other person has it all figured out. It's so easy for me to let my emotions swamp me and the rest of all the things that I know to be true and run away with my thoughts and my spirit. In that situation, doubt is not a protection against ridicule. Doubt is eating away at what I know and believe, causing me to be uncertain about things that I was previously certain. Doubt ceases to be what defends my self-esteem and starts to be what tears down my self-esteem. We often compete with each other to determine whose ideas and ideals stand up the best under scrutiny. But if what we believe isn't based on something more than how clever we are or how well we've been taught, well, then we're just playing a game in who can outmaneuver whom. Real faith comes from something bigger than we are. Real understanding comes from a perspective larger than our own. Doubt can be a shield that we use to keep at bay the need to define what it is that we believe, a defense mechanism to protect against ridicule. Doubt can be a challenge to our confidence and faith, a corrosive element born of fear and uncertainty, and we need to reject those sorts of doubts. They do us no good. They do us harm. But can we ever really do away with doubt? Would we really want to? While doubt is generally thought of as in negative terms, and most often it is a negative influence, doubt does have some value. Because we have to acknowledge that our understanding of ourselves, of this world, and of God is incomplete. We live with doubt because we do not fully understand. We exist in the tension between what we know and what we do not know, and the difficulty of being able to tell the difference between those two things. We read in 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 13, love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. The Apostle Paul in this passage speaks about development and growth in understanding. He acknowledges that our understanding is not yet complete and will not be complete until we pass from this life. The skeptic in me wants to jump up and shout out that nothing is certain and that it's right to question things. To accept something without questioning it at all seems silly to me. I have to be able to understand something, at least in part, before I'm able to accept it into my system of beliefs. Now, I don't really understand the concept of Trinity, that God can be three, and at the same time, God is one. Nothing else in our world is both plural and singular in the way that God is both plural and singular. There's no metaphor that we can adopt, no example that we can show that will explain to somebody three and one simultaneously. It doesn't make sense. I can't understand the full nature of God because God is so much more than I am. And I can understand the concept of Trinity, but I can never fully wrap my head around it. I can accept that God is who God is, that God is beyond my ability to fully comprehend. But I am but a human, and God is God. And there will always be more to know, more to understand, further complexity and depth, that even if it's explained to me, I'm not going to get it. And that's where we live in our lives of faith. If we feel that we've got it all figured out, we're confused. There's always something more. There's always something deeper. And even when it's explained to us by God Himself in His Word, my limited human brain just can't take it all in. Thomas presents us with a particularly stubborn account of doubt. Thomas had spent 3 years living and working with 11 other disciples following Jesus, and presumably there had been some measure of trust and bonding that had occurred between these young men as they were taught and trained by Jesus, who was their rabbi, their teacher. And yet, when Thomas is confronted by the reality that all of his fellow students were telling him the same eyewitness story, he refused to believe it. Now, I could understand Thomas's reaction better if only one or two of his fellow students were telling him this story. I could understand his reaction if they had only found a note written by Jesus that seemed to explain that he was still alive. But I don't understand why he would challenge this entire group of people that he had spent 3 years living with and working alongside when they were all telling him about something they had seen with their own eyes. To challenge the entire group about something they were telling me. That would take a lot. This is a strong statement. He demanded proof. But the fact that Thomas doubted is very useful for us today. There are many who are skeptical about who Jesus was, where he came from, and what actually happened to him. And for those who might think that the biblical account of Jesus' resurrection is all just a little bit too convenient, perhaps it was all staged. Well, in response to that, we have Thomas, who didn't play along with any sort of script that might have been handed out to him. I look at Thomas's reaction. I put myself in his shoes, and I think to myself, maybe I would have reacted the same way. Perhaps Thomas refused to believe because the cost of choosing to believe and then finding out that it was all a joke or that someone was mistaken, that was just too high of a cost for him. We look at Thomas and perhaps believe that he wasn't serious enough about his faith to believe what he was told. Maybe, though, in Thomas's case and in other cases, those who hold themselves back do so because faith means a lot to them, and they aren't willing to change their minds lightly. Thomas had lost someone extremely important to him, and the thought of losing him and finding him and losing him again was just more than he could bear. When I first read this passage, I thought of Jesus chiding Thomas for his lack of faith. I thought of Thomas' reaction as stubbornness, doubt because of pride. Maybe Jesus wasn't taking Thomas to task for pride, but telling him that it was safe to put aside the doubt and believe because he knew how badly Thomas wanted to believe. Doubt will be with us until we know for certain. When we, like Thomas, come face to face with God, as the dim glass is pulled away, revealing all that God is and all that we are, and we will see the holes in his hands, in his feet, and in his side, and we will know beyond all doubt. But until we do, we need to risk our hearts and be willing to believe despite the uncertainty, because the danger of believing in nothing is greater than the danger of bruised pride or a battered heart. The value of doubt is that it teaches us humility. When thoughtful doubt comes into contact with a strong sense of faith, it allows that faith to be shaped and molded, becoming more conformed to the character of Christ. And our faith needs to be firm, but open to correcting our misunderstandings. We need to expect growth, development, and adaptation in our lives of faith, because the circumstances that we find ourselves in are constantly changing. We should not abandon the truth of Scripture, but we must always be ready to reevaluate how that truth ought to be applied in our lives. A faith without any doubt is brittle and unable to change and adapt and grow. None of us has it all figured out, and we need to continually explore God's Word and allow it to penetrate our hearts and minds, transforming us. We should come to faith with an expectation that God has something new to teach us. New growth in our understanding. Some new vision of how we might live out the gospel. As we read in Romans 12, 1-2, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." May we accept the Holy Spirit, who teaches us to trust in Christ's sacrifice. May we follow Jesus' guidance as he shows the way to the Father. And may we seek to honor the Father and glorify his name as he delivers to us the gift of the Spirit living within. Let us pray. Father, we pray that this morning, as we consider the value of doubt and the meaning of faith, we pray that we will see new paths to new understandings, that our eyes may be opened, that the scales may fall away, and that we will know your presence, your love, and your Holy Spirit. We will embrace who you are in our lives, our Lord and our God. Bless us, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. As we prepare for communion this morning, we're going to stand and sing a song called Majesty. And as we're doing that, if you're in the outer peripherals, if you're able to move into the center, it's just great if we're closer together. Gives us a great family and closeness feel. So as we're singing this song, let's just try and move into the center a little bit more if you're able. And let's stand and let's sing together Majesty.
Here I am, humbled by your majesty, covered by your grace so free. Here I am, knowing I'm a sinful man, covered by the blood of the Lamb. Now I found the greatest love of all is mine, since you laid down your life, the greatest sacrifice. Has found me just as I am, empty-handed but alive in your hands. Here I am, humbled by the love that you give, forgiven so that I can forgive. Here I stand, knowing that I'm desire, sanctified by glory and fire. Now I found the greatest love of all is mine, since you laid down your life, the greatest sacrifice. Majesty, your grace has found me just as I am, empty-handed but alive in your hands. Majesty, majesty, forever I am changed by your love, in the presence of your majesty. Stay.
Yes, that's great. Jesus took his disciples to the upper room where the meal had been prepared, and they were celebrating the Passover, something with deep history and tradition. They all knew what the various elements meant. And at the end of that meal, Jesus took what they knew, what they understood, and he transformed it, making it deeper and more meaningful. He took the bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body." May we have the prayer for the bread.
Heavenly Father, we want to give you thanks in the name of Jesus that you have sent your Son into this world for our benefit and for your glory. And as he died on the cross and gave his body as the sacrifice on our behalf, new life appeared for us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for that sacrifice that you have made. And you show us that sacrifice as we could also replicate that in our lives and then live for you to the glory of your name. As we celebrate your body being given for us, we give you thanks that life has come to us all new because of you, Lord Jesus Christ, and your sacrifice. Amen.
The body of Christ, broken, that you may find wholeness. Take and eat. In the same way, he took the cup, and having blessed it, said, "This is my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of your sins." Let us have the prayer for the cup.
Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the fact that not only Jesus came to earth, but he won the battle in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said, "Not my will, but yours be done," when he knew what was facing him, not just the physical agony of the cross, but the spiritual battle of Satan's forces arrayed against him to put him in the tomb. And he knew that you were going to resurrect him from the dead. And Lord, we're thankful. We're thankful, Lord, that it says in your word that without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of our sins. And it was your blood, Lord Jesus, that was the precious blood, as the Apostle Peter tells us, the precious blood of the Lord Jesus that was shed on Calvary's cross to bring redemption to us who are sinners that are unworthy of anything, any grace at all, undeserved. But we come to you, Lord, with thanksgiving and with praise and with the adoration and glorifying your name and glorifying who you are, Lord, for that ultimate sacrifice of your precious blood on our behalf. We pray this in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
The blood that was spilled, that you might be forgiven, take and drink. Excuse me. My wife Monica has introduced me to a tradition of giving out grapes to the children who do not come forward for communion, because God's love and grace for us does not begin when we accept God's love into our hearts. It begins from our very earliest days, and all the children are welcome to come forward and have a few grapes off of this tray. God loves you. God loves you. You can take a couple. God's love for us is a wonderful thing. And as we prepare to depart and go and enjoy what has been prepared for us, may you believe, not without any doubt, but understanding that we do not yet fully know. And there is confusion, there is uncertainty, but we can be certain of God's love for us because we can taste it. In his name, go from this place in peace. Amen.
If you are affiliated with Calvary Baptist Church, we encourage you to continue your regular support. Or if you are a visitor and would like to support this ministry, please send your contributions to the address posted on the screen. Or you can send your support with an e-transfer to the email address also posted on the screen. Thank you for joining us, as we trust you have met with the resurrected Jesus along with us today. May the love of Jesus be your joy this week.